Welcome to the Shepherd's Chapel Network Family Bible Study Hour with Pastor Dennis Murray. Wisdom is understanding God's Word. Pastor Murray's unique teaching approach brings God's Word alive with meaning as he takes you on a chapter-by-chapter, verse-by-verse study of God's letter to you, the Bible. And now, here is Pastor Dennis Murray.
Good day to you. God bless you. Welcome to Shepherd's Chapel. Welcome to this Family Bible Study Hour. Ready to get back into our Father's Word here at the chapel? We invite you to get your Bible and join us if you care to. We're going to pick it up today, 2 Kings chapter 4, verse 8. And things are going very badly in the 10 tribes to the north, commonly referred to as Israel. From the time of Jeroboam, the first king after the nation split, you had Israel in one house and Judah the other, the nation split down the middle. And you had Jeroboam who made the golden calves and said to the people of Israel, you don't have to go down to Jerusalem to worship. Worship these two golden calves. You see, he was afraid that the people would stay in Judah if they went to Jerusalem because things were going so badly in the 10 tribes to the north. And then you had Ahab with his Baal worship closed down the house of God, the temple, and basically forbade the people from worshiping Yahweh, the God of heaven and earth, worship this heathenistic god Baal. Well, God sent prophet after prophet trying to get the people's attention, to raise their conscience, to realize that there was a God in Israel, and his name wasn't Baal. So with that introduction, we're going to pick it up today. We ask that word of wisdom in Yeshua's precious name, Father. We ask you to open eyes, open ears this day. We pick it up, 2 Kings chapter 4, verse 8, and it reads, "And it fell on a day that Elisha passed to Shunem, where was a great woman." This means that she was a woman of substance, a wealthy woman. "And she constrained him to eat bread. And so it was that as oft as he passed by, he turned in thither to eat bread." They developed a relationship, evidently he liked her and she liked him, and she sensed something about Elisha as well. Verse 9, "And she said unto her husband, Behold now, I perceive that this is an holy man of God, which passeth by us continually." She felt the presence of the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of God. And that was something that you wouldn't feel from very many people in Israel at this time. You see, all the priests had moved out of the allotments of land, the cities that they were assigned to when Israel first went into the promised land, when they saw Jeroboam making the golden calves and creating his own priesthood, promoting or consecrating his own priest. They all headed for Judah. They knew things were not going well with the 10 northern tribes. This woman perceived something very righteous about Elisha. Verse 10, "Let us make a little chamber, a little room, if you will," she continues to her husband, "I pray thee, on the wall, and let us set for him there a bed and a table and a stool and a candlestick. And it shall be when he cometh to us that he shall turn in thither." And this is, you know, pretty merciful, or this woman is really showing a lot of care for Elisha. I couldn't help, when I read this verse, my mind racing back to 1991. And my wife and I had the good fortune of visiting her family in Germany. And in 1991, that's the year the wall came down. We were there 3 months after the wall came down. And we visited a little town the first time that we went from West Germany to East Germany. There was a little town in East Germany called Eisenach, which means iron axe. And it's quite a thing to see if you ever have the opportunity. But the first thing that struck me about this castle, and it was an old castle, was that there was a cross built into the building itself. And most of the facility had been remodeled over the years and made into a tourist attraction. But there was one little room that I'll never forget. And it was in its original form as it was in the 1500s. That room belonged to Martin Luther, a man who did many religious writings, was very qualified in translating the original languages. But that room, what struck me about this verse was, that's all that was in there, was a bed, a table, a stool, and a candlestick that he would work late in the night translating. So it was quite an exciting trip. Verse 11, and it fell on a day that he came thither, and he turned into the chamber and lay there. Shunem, by the way, in the Hebrew is solam. Of today, it means double resting place. Shiloh is a form of the word which means single resting place. So Shunem became a resting place for Elisha as he journeyed about on his business. Very gracious of this wealthy woman to take care of him, so he's going to try and return the favor. Verse 12, and he, this being Elisha, said to Gehazi his servant, call this Shunammite. And when he had called her, she stood before him. And he's going to just send a message, you know, how can I repay you for your graciousness? And I think rather than he going himself, he sent Gehazi in that she might be a little more free to say to Gehazi what that Elisha could do for her. Verse 13, and he said unto him, this is Elisha to Gehazi his servant, behold, thou hast been very careful for us with all this care. What is to be done for thee? Question. Wouldest thou be spoken for to the king? Do you have any wishes or petitions that I could present to the king for you? Or to the captain of the host, the general of the military? And she answered, I dwell among mine own people. In other words, I have no need of anything. I dwell peacefully among mine own people. And believe me, Elisha could have called in a favor or two from the king, not only the king of Israel, but the king of Judah and the deputy king of Edom. You remember in our last lecture where they found themselves in a pickle. They were out in the middle of the desert making their way around Edom to fight against the Moabites, and they had no water. And they called on Elisha, and Elisha made the Lord through Elisha made the water flow to where the people and their animals had water to drink. Not only the kings, but also the military as well. So believe me, Elisha could have called in a favor or two had the woman had a request. But she doesn't need anything. She's happy. No thanks. Thanks, but no thanks. Verse 14. And he said, what then is to be done for her? Question. And Gehazi answered, verily, she hath no child, and her husband is old. I noticed that they don't have a child, and they're very wealthy people. We've already established that in verse 8 when it said that she was a great woman. But there is no heir to their fortune, and Gehazi noticed this. Anytime I think about an elderly couple that don't have children, I can't help but think about Abram and Sarai in Genesis chapter 18, who Abram was almost 100 years old, Sarai 90 years old, when the Lord told her that she was going to have a son, verse 15. And he said, this is Elisha, call her, and when he had called her, she stood in the door. She's about to learn that the God of Abraham still rules and reigns in Israel. All of these miracles performed by the prophets were meant and intended to raise the consciousness of the people, to make them realize that there was a God in Israel and his name was not Baal. Verse 16. And he said this to the Shunammite woman, about this season, in other words, about this time next year, according to the time of life, thou shalt embrace a son. And she said, nay, my lord, thou man of God, do not lie unto thine handmaid. Don't tease me, probably would be a better way to translate this, or don't deceive me. And you know, when the Lord told Sarai that she was going to have a son, she laughed within herself, and thus the name of her firstborn son, Isaac, which if you translate it rather than transliterate it, it means laughter. Verse 17, and the woman conceived, the Shunammitess, and bear a son at that season, at the time of year, in other words, that Elisha had said unto her, according to the time of life, according to the time of gestation, 9 months that the child would take to develop and be ready to be birthed. Verse 18, and when the child was grown, it fell on a day that he went out to his father to the reapers. He went out to help with the harvest. The woman's faith in the Lord, the God of Israel, is about to be tested and confirmed. Verse 19, and he said unto his father, this is the lad, her son, my head, my head. And he said to the lad, carry him to his mother, he said to one of the other helpers, take him back to the house, to his mother. It's thought that he likely had a heat stroke. Heat stroke causes a very severe headache. And in this case, it's going to cause death as well. Verse 20, and when he had taken him, he brought him to his mother. He sat on her knees till noon and then died. A heat stroke causes inflammation in the brain, and likely what took the lad's life. 21. And she, the Shunammite woman, went up and laid him on a bed, the bed of the man of God, in Elisha's room that she had built for him, and shut the door upon him and went out. She realizes that her son is dead, but she also knows that it was Elisha who, or she perceives that it was Elisha who had the power to give her a son. It wasn't Elisha's power, it was the power of the God of Israel, Yahweh. But she's thinking, well, Elisha gave me the son, perhaps he can bring him back to life. 22. And she called unto her husband and said, send me, I pray thee, one of the young men and one of the asses, that I may run to the man of God and come again. Note, she didn't say anything about our son being dead. Why? Verse 23. And he said, wherefore wilt thou go to him today? It is neither new moon nor Sabbath. And she said, it shall be well. In other words, it's not the days that you would normally go and worship with Elisha. Why today? And with this word, it shall be well, which she responded, the Hebrew word for well is shalom, a word that many of you are familiar with, most often translated from the Hebrew into English as peace. It can also mean never mind, and that's what it means in this case. She doesn't have time to explain to her husband why she wants to go to Elisha. Don't delay me, let me go. Verse 24. Then she saddled an ass and said to her servant, drive and go forward. Slack not thy riding for me, except I bid thee. Don't hold back and slow down because of me. This is urgent. We need to press on, and unless I ask you to slow down, go as fast as you can. Verse 25. So she went and came unto the man of God to Mount Carmel. And it came to pass, when the man of God saw her afar off, that he said to Gehazi his servant, behold, yonder is that Shunammite. He recognized her, and he realized that she is and her servant are riding very hard. He realizes probably that something is amiss. Verse 26. Run now, Elisha, to Gehazi, instruction. Run now, I pray thee, to meet her, and say unto her, is it well with thee? Is it well with thy husband? Is it well with the child? And she answered, it is well. Again, this word well means shalom. In other words, don't delay me, never mind. She didn't want to tell Gehazi. She's insisting on seeing Elisha and telling him that her son is dead. Verse 27. And when she came to the man of God to the hill, she caught him by the feet. But Gehazi came near to thrust her away, to throw her away or pull her away. Gehazi, as his servant, is protecting his master. And the man of God, Elisha, said, let her alone, for her soul is vexed within her. In the Hebrew, this word vexed means it's bitter within her. And the Lord hath hid it from me and hath not told me. Now, think about this. The woman had been blessed with a child in their old age. And now the child had been taken away. Elisha doesn't know this. God did not tell him for some reason. The woman's not going to tell him either, but he can tell by the questions that the lad is dead. Verse 28. Then she said, did I desire a son of my Lord? Did I not say, do not deceive me? This is the woman to Elisha. Did I ask for a son? Didn't I say, don't tease me or don't deceive me? She didn't say what the matter was, but the questions that she's asking Elisha make him realize that the son is dead. 29. Then he said to Gehazi, gird up thy loins and take my staff in thine hand and go thy way. If thou meet any man, salute him not. Don't stop to even talk. And if any man salute thee, answer him not again. Don't waste any time. And lay my staff upon the face of the child. You hurry there, Gehazi, and when you arrive, you lay my staff on the child's corpse. Verse 30. And the mother of the child said, as the Lord liveth, this is an oath, and as thy soul liveth, very sincere oath, I will not leave thee. And he, this being Elisha, arose and followed her. Elisha was just going to send Gehazi to the deceased son. The woman is insisting that, you know, she's thinking back that Elisha asked if there was anything he could do for her, and she basically said, no, I'm happy. Now she has something that she wants Elisha to do, and she's insisting that it be Elisha that come, not just Gehazi. Probably a good thing. Verse 31. And Gehazi passed on before them, and laid the staff upon the face of the child. But there was neither voice nor hearing. In the Hebrew, this is, there was no attention. There was no response, in other words. Wherefore he went again to meet him, referring to Elisha, and told him, saying, the child is not awaked. And of course, you and I know that it was only God that could make this child come to life again. It wasn't Gehazi's power. It wasn't the staff of Elisha. It wasn't Elisha's power that could bring this child back to life. It was the power of God Almighty, of course. And again, this is going to happen so that the people of Israel, who have really not, they've forgotten God. They've turned their back on God. And the purpose of these miracles, to raise their conscience to where they would realize that there is a God of Israel. Verse 32. And when Elisha was come into the house, behold, the child was dead and laid upon his bed. There was a similar situation with Elijah. You may recall back in 1 Kings chapter 17, when we were first introduced to the prophet Elijah. And you remember he was sent to dwell with a widow in Zidon. And there wasn't enough to eat. And he told her there'll be sufficient of the oil and the meal to last. And there was a terrible drought and famine in the land at the time. But her son passed away, you recall. And Elijah, through the power of God, brought him back to life. Verse 33. He went in, therefore, Elisha going into the deceased son, and shut the door upon them twain, on the two of them. Only the two, the dead child and Elisha, were in there, and prayed unto the Lord. Elisha knew whose power it was to revive this child. And he went up and lay upon the child, and put his mouth upon his mouth, and his eyes upon his eyes, and his hands upon his hands. And he stretched himself upon the child, and the flesh of the child waxed warm. It became warm. He's coming back to life. Verse 35, then he returned and walked in the house to and fro, and went up and stretched himself upon him. And the child sneezed seven times, and the child opened his eyes. God had brought the child back to life. This was the seventh miracle performed by Elisha. And you know, there are several people who brought people back from the dead in the New Testament. Peter brought a child back from death. Paul was long preaching one night. Paul got kind of long-winded sometimes when he was preaching. And it was so one night that a young man who fell asleep while Paul was preaching in the window of the third floor fell out and died from the fall. And Paul brought him to life. And of course, Jesus Christ brought a child and Lazarus back to life when he said, Lazarus, come forth. Verse 36. And he called Gehazi and said, call this Shunammite. So he called her. And when she was come in unto him, he said, take up thy son. In other words, your son lives again. Then she went in and fell at his feet and bowed herself to the ground and took up her son and went out. Again, the miracles were intended to make the people of Israel realize that there was a God of Israel. It wasn't a golden calf, and his name was not Baal. Verse 38. And Elisha came again to Gilgal, this being one of the locations where Elijah had established a school for the prophets. And there was a dearth, there was a famine in the land. and the sons of the prophets were sitting before him. And he said unto his servant, set on the great pot, and seethe or boil pottage for the sons of the prophets. Now, he's got 100 prophets, we're going to find out there in the next few verses. And Elisha, he's an optimist. He's saying, get the big pot and get some water boiling. We're getting ready to eat, and we're going to eat and have plenty. This verse, I couldn't help but remember one of my father's friends. He was a rugged man. He spent weeks at a time camped out in Alaska. You've heard Pastor Arnold Murray tell the story about finding buttercups in an ox's mouth, a bison's mouth, from when the freeze came on so quickly. That was Bill McQuarrie who told him about that. Bill McQuarrie was sitting in our living room, my father, Arnold, and myself. I must have been a teenager at the time. But Bill McQuarrie, I'll never forget, he said, Arnold, you are an optimist. And Arnold said, well, how so? And he said, well, you know, you're never worried about where your next can of food is coming from because you got a can opener. And that's what Elisha is doing here. He's saying, get the big pot, fill it with water, and get some water boiling. We're going to eat. Excuse me, verse 39. And one, this is one of the students or sons of the prophets, disciples of the prophets, one went out into the field to gather herbs. Remember, there's nothing to eat. And found a wild vine and gathered thereof wild gourds his lap full. You see, men wore skirts at this time. And this is saying he formed like a basket with his skirt and filled it up, and that's what this his lap full means. Excuse me. And came and shred them into the pot of pottage, for they knew them not. They weren't familiar with these gourd-like looking fruit. And the reason they weren't familiar was because they were awful. They were probably colocynths, which is a wild cucumber. And they are very, very bitter. Verse 40. So they poured out for the men to eat, the sons of the prophets at Gilgal, the prophet's school. And it came to pass, as they were eating of the pottage, that they cried out and said, O thou man of God, there is death in this pot. And they could not eat thereof. It was so terrible that they could not, and they were probably hungry, but it still was so terrible that they could not bear to eat it. This, that there is death in this pot, you could think of for that which causes death, such as poison. 41, another miracle about to happen. But he said, then bring meal, this is Elisha, and he cast it into the pot, and he said, pour out for the people that they may eat, and there was no harm in the pot. There was no evil thing in the pot. What is meal? Well, meal is the substance from which the bread of life comes. The bread of life, of course, spiritually speaking, is our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. The lesson that we can learn from this, if you put the bread of life in something that is evil, the evil leaves it and is gone. Verse 42. And there came a man from Baal Shalisha and brought to the man of God bread of the first fruits. The bread of the first fruits belongs to the priests. 20 loaves of barley and full ears of corn in the husk. One man realized carried all this. And he said, Elisha, give unto the people that they may eat. Now, you know, this seems like a lot, 20 loaves of barley, full ears of corn in the husk, but they got 100 people there and they're hungry. And Elisha is saying, give to the people, so the hundreds, so that they can eat. Verse 43, and his servitor, probably Gehazi, his servant, said, what, should I set this before 100 men? There isn't enough, Elisha. He said again, give the people that they may eat, for thus saith the Lord, they shall eat and shall leave thereof. Couldn't help but think about Christ feeding the multitudes with 5 loaves and 2 fishes. He fed 5,000 with 5 loaves and 2 fishes. That was the men only. That doesn't include the women and the children. And do you remember what was left? They picked up 12 baskets of fragments, and they shall eat and shall leave thereof. And certainly they did. Verse 44, so he set it before them, and they did eat and left thereof according to the word of the Lord, enough for all. And that's what we can learn from this. The bread of life, spiritually speaking, there's enough for all. You know, this pottage that was mended by Elisha, I think what we can learn from that is that, you know, we can partake of spiritual food, we need to make sure and guard against partaking of the traditions of men. And you see, and today in many churches, instead of getting the bread of life, instead of getting the word of God taught chapter by chapter, verse by verse, people are filled with a bunch of traditions of men. You know, that just won't get it when you're spiritually hungry. The traditions of men will not satisfy you. Anytime I think about spiritual starvation, my mind races to Ezekiel chapter 37. And remember, they're in the valley of dry bones. And the Lord asked Ezekiel, said, what seest? What do you see there, Ezekiel? And he said, oh, I see a bunch of dry bones. People are spiritually starved to death. And the Lord asked Ezekiel, said, well, can these bones live? And Ezekiel said, you know, I don't know, Lord, you do. And then what happened? The Lord told Ezekiel, you prophesy to those bones. Prophesy, one of the meanings of the word is to teach. You teach those dry bones the word of God. And he began to prophesy. He began to teach the word of God to those who were so the skeletons, they was all that was left. They were spiritually starved to death. And when Ezekiel started speaking and teaching the word of God, what happened? Bone upon bone and sinew upon sinew, they began to come back to life. The word of God is life. We've got a short message. We'll ask you to listen a moment. Won't you please?
The Mark of the Beast on CD is our free introductory offer to you. What is the Mark of the Beast? Many false teachers would have you believe it will be a tattoo on your forehead or a computer chip implanted under your skin. It's getting late in the game. You need to know what the Mark of the Beast is. As it's written in Revelation chapter 13, verse 8, many will be deceived. Christ said in Mark 13, 23, behold, I have foretold you all things. Jesus indeed told us how not to be deceived, and Pastor Arnold Murray takes you on a step-by-step study of God's Word concerning this critical subject. The telephone call is free, the CD is free, no shipping and handling. Just call 800-643-4645 to request your one-time, one-per-household copy of The Mark of the Beast. You may also mail your request to Shepherd's Chapel, P.O. Box 416, Gravette, Arkansas, 72736. Don't be deceived by Satan.
Welcome back. We're glad you could join back with us. Let's have the 800 number, please. 800-643-4645. That number good throughout Puerto Rico, the U.S., and Canada. If you have a biblical question that you'd like to pose to be answered on the air, feel free to call that 800 number and leave your question. Please don't ask questions about a specific individual, denomination, or organization by name. We try to teach God's word in a positive manner. Throwing out negative about others by name serves no purpose, especially our brothers and sisters in Christ, and we just won't do it. We'll let God's word do the teaching, the correcting, and the healing, fully capable of all three. If you're studying via the internet somewhere around the world that's not able to use that 800 number, your announcer at the end of the hour will give you our mailing address. Quite all right to mail your questions in. Got a prayer request? We can do away with the telephone number. You don't need to call anyone. Talk with your Heavenly Father. I encourage you to do that. Make time each day. I know everyone's busy, running here, running there, making a living, but make time for your Father. I'll tell you, he can kick the rocks out of your path. You know, if you think you don't have time to talk to your Father, well, you're wasting time walking around all those rocks that are in your path. I'm talking about the storms that come our way in life. God can smooth all that out for you if you have the right kind of relationship with Him. Tell Him that you love Him. Let Him help you make important decisions in your life. He's the best counsel you can have. We do have these prayer requests. Father, we come united as one in the name of Your Son, Jesus Christ, Father. We ask You to look upon these. You know their problems, marital problems, financial difficulties. You know, if it is Your will, a special blessing on each of these. We also lift up our military troops who are in harm's way around the world. Father, watch over, guide, protect, touch, heal in Jesus' precious name. Amen and thank You, Father. All right. And before I get started into questions, I'm going to announce one more time that beginning at the first of the year, if you're watching the live program, we're going 24/7, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week on Dish Network. We had a little snafu on getting some of the channel names changed over due to the holidays, but I understand that that will be corrected very shortly. We've changed the name of the channel to the BIBLE, the Bible channel, and again, we're on 24/7 beginning at the first of the year. We thank God for the platform that He's given us. Mark in New York has our first question. Is there a payday in the afterlife? Yes, but you know, you really don't have to wait until the afterlife for a payday. If you do things God's way, as I said just a moment ago, He can kick rocks out of the path for you. He can smooth your way through the life. He can bless you if He chooses to do so, and that's a payday in itself. You know, when we pass away, you mentioned the afterlife, there's a form of judgment immediately. Why do I say that? Because there are two sides to the gulf. There's a side where righteous people go, such as Lazarus of Luke chapter 16. There's a not so good side where the unrighteous people go, like the rich man of Luke chapter 16. Then, of course, we have the great white throne judgment of Revelation chapter 20. That's when we really get our rewards, entrance into the kingdom of God, that's to say, the eternity. Rufus in Georgia. Did Paul have a brother named Rufus? And he mentions Romans chapter 16, verse 13. And Rufus of Romans 16, 13 was not a brother to Paul of the same womb. In chapter 16, Paul is recognizing all that were helping in the ministry. And he calls many of them kinsmen. But he doesn't mean that they're blood relatives. He means that they're brothers, such as we say today, members of our congregation, are our brothers and sisters in Christ. Florence in New York. Jesus is God's son, so we wondered, since Jesus is a Jew, if everyone should be using the Jewish religion. Please answer this on TV. Thank you so very much. We enjoy your TV program very much here in New York. Well, we're glad that you enjoy the teaching. You know, Jesus, first of all, let me say, was born of Mary. That's where we would have to look then to determine what his genealogy was. Mary's mother, as we can prove from Luke chapter 1, was of the daughters of Aaron, meaning she was a direct descendant of the house of Aaron, the priesthood, in other words, a Levite. And on her father's side, we can prove that genealogy in Luke chapter 3. Mary's father's name was Heli, and he was of the tribe of Judah. This is where the misunderstanding that Jesus was a Jew comes from. It's a bad translation. He was of Judah. He lived and resided in the land of Judea, and that's where this comes from. Judah in the Greek language is Iudas. Veronica in Florida, and no, the religion you should be practicing is Christianity, if you call yourself a follower of Christ. Veronica in Florida, what does it mean when Jesus says to deny oneself and to pick up your cross daily and follow him? Well, the Lord means by that to be prepared to deny your carnal or your flesh desires and be willing to pick up a cross such as he picked up a cross to be crucified on for our sins. Did he ask us to be crucified on the cross? No, but we should be willing to do so. Mabel in South Carolina, someone told me that Jesus' name was to be Michael before he was born. Is this true? No, and that is nigh unto blasphemy. You see, Michael is an archangel. We don't worship angels, and as an angel told John in the book of Revelation, John fell down at the angel's feet and started to worship him, and the angel said, "Get up from there, see thou do it not. I'm but a fellow servant." We don't worship fellow servants of the Lord. We worship the Lord. Michael's an archangel, completely separate entity from Jesus Christ. Jose in Georgia, what does the number 22 mean? Well, in biblical numerics, which I'm sure is what Jose means, 22 is the number of disintegration and disorganization. 22 is the number associated with the reigns of King Ahab of Israel and Manasseh, another king of Israel, arguably the two worst kings of Israel. And disintegration and disorganization abounded during their reigns of Israel. We're reading about some of the after effects of their reigns, Ahab in particular, as we study the book of 2 Kings. Manasseh is coming up. Linda in New Jersey, where are the Ten Commandments found in the Bible? I always remember that because there are how many Ten Commandments? Well, there are 10 of them. Well, you'll find the Ten Commandments in the second book of the Bible, and there are, if you multiply it times 2, the Ten Commandments, it's chapter 20. Again, it's the second book, Exodus. There are 10 commandments. It's in the second book. You multiply that by there, 20. Chapter 20 is where you will find the 10 commandments. The first 5 of the 10 commandments deal with man's relationship with God. The second 5 deal with man's relationship with other people. Robert in Arizona, Numbers chapter 20, please explain. Why wasn't Moses following the pillar of the cloud? Now, Numbers chapter 20 is where the water of Meribah comes up. The people once again of Israel were bellyaching and murmuring against Moses and God, for that matter. And they were saying, you brought us out here in this wilderness. This was after they came out of Egypt, to die. There's no water. There's no food. And God instructed Moses, you go out and you speak to the rock to sanctify me, and I will bring water out of the rock. Well, what did Moses do? Well, Moses took the rock out and he said, hear me, ye rebels. Must we, referring to himself and Aaron and God, bring water forth from this rock? I don't think God would have needed Moses' help or Aaron's help to bring water forth from that rock. And then Moses struck the rock twice. He didn't follow God's instructions. It made God very angry. It cost Moses and Aaron the journey into the promised land because of what they did. You know, there's a very valuable lesson in that, I think, for God's election. And that is that when you're delivered up before the synagogues of Satan, you're going to be called upon to witness against the Antichrist and for the true Christ. It's not you who actually speaks, though. It's the Holy Spirit that speaks. And when God says speak, speak. If he doesn't say speak, keep your mouth shut. It could be the unpardonable sin for God's elect. Judy in California, is there a fourth archangel by the name of Ariel? No, not in the King James Version Bible. You will find the word, the Hebrew word, Ariel, the name, in Isaiah chapter 29, verses 1 through 7. Ariel, if you translate it, means lion or hearth of God. There in Isaiah chapter 29, the first several verses, it's referring to the city of Jerusalem. Now, as far as other archangels, the only two archangels that you'll find mentioned by name in the King James Version Bible are one, Michael, and two, Gabriel. If you have an Apocrypha, there is a book of the Bible, Book of the Apocrypha, which was part of the original King James Version 1611 Bible, the Apocrypha was, but the powers of the church did not canonize those books, therefore you won't find them in your Bible today. Again, there are some other archangels named in the Apocrypha. Kathy in Florida, thank you for your study on floods, and you're welcome. I have a question for you. I have a friend who is a new Christian, and I tried explaining to her that Eve was seduced by Satan and that Cain was not Adam's son, but Satan's son. I told her she could find it in St. John. I just wasn't sure which chapter and verse, but I thought it was the first chapter. Well, it's actually John chapter 8, verse 44 is the scripture that you're looking for, where Christ is speaking to the Kenites, which are descendants of Cain. And he tells them there, you are of your father, the devil. He was a murderer from the beginning. Who was the first murderer? Cain slew Abel. Also in the first epistle of John, now that may be what you were talking about, the first chapter, the first epistle of John, chapter 3, verse 12, it reads there, not as Cain, who was of that wicked one. And those are both New Testament references that state that Cain was not of Adam. It's easy to prove that Cain was not of Adam. Go to Adam's genealogy in Genesis chapter 5. You won't find Cain there. Why? Because Cain was not Adam's son. You'll find Cain's genealogy in Genesis chapter 4. Andy from California. I've been studying with you since 2006. It was coming across you that reeled me in. you were and are calm and have a great sense of humor. Well, thank you for that. Your dad said many times, people without good works will be naked as a jaybird. These are people on the right side of the gulf. Truly to believe, Father, would not make someone be embarrassed and humiliated once they get to the right side. What do you say to this? Well, I would tend to agree with you that if you make it to the right side of the gulf, you're not going to be naked. You had some righteous works. And of course, the biblical scriptures that we come to that conclusion from are Revelation chapter 13, verse 14, where we learn that the only thing that you can take with you when you die are your works, whether good, bad, or ugly. Then in Revelation chapter 12, we learn that your righteous acts are what make up the robe of which is Revelation 19, excuse me, that your robe is made up of. If you don't have righteous acts, no robe, in other words. Arthur in Tennessee. I live in, he didn't mention the town, I would like the answer to these two questions. God knows all and sees all. Why did he make the angels, and one of them was the devil? Well, originally, you see, Satan wasn't evil. God didn't create Satan to be evil. He became that way. We learn that in Ezekiel chapter 27, where Satan is called the king of Tyre. He was a pretty good old boy to coming out the chute. And the fact is, he earned the right to be one of the cherubs that protects the mercy seat. We learn there in Ezekiel 27. What happened, though? Well, he got all puffed up in himself. He got off on an ego trip, and he wanted to sit on the mercy seat rather than protect the mercy seat. And that's where God sentenced him to be turned to ashes from within. That will happen in the lake of fire. Teresa from Michigan, I am so very grateful for your teachings, and I tell it so on Facebook so that more of my friends and family can hopefully get turned on and tuned in. My question is, why is it that, I think this is, farmers leave a single tree in the center of their fields? I think it has something biblical, but I don't know the specifics of it. If you could read it on the air in the mornings when I study with you, I'd greatly appreciate it. Thank you, and God bless you, your family, and your staff. And thanks for remembering us in your prayers. You are in our prayers as well. Well, in Arkansas, farmers and ranchers leave a few trees in the pasture to provide some shade. It gets awfully hot and humid in Arkansas in the summertime, and you want to provide a little bit of shade for your livestock in that case. I think maybe what you're thinking about is that it is biblical that when it was time to harvest the fruit of the trees, such as the olive trees, that the farmers weren't to glean, is what the word is in the Bible. That means to take everything, get the last little olive on the highest limb and take it for yourself. But you don't do that according to God's word. You leave a little bit of what's left over on the trees for the poor. And that may be what you're thinking about. Rosalie in South Dakota. Why do I cry so often? When spiritual songs are sung, I cry. When something nice happens to me or someone else, I cry. When anyone has transgressions, I cry. I cry very easily and almost anything at the drop at almost anything at the drop of a hat, but I do not know why. Can you tell me why I cry and thank you for explaining God's Word, the Bible, and you're welcome for that. Well, it sounds to me, Rosalie, like you're a very compassionate, sensitive person. And you know, that is one characteristic of God's elect that I've noticed over the years, is that they are very compassionate people. They care about their brothers and sisters who are lost in this world of darkness. And we work very hard through this ministry trying to pull every one of them that we can out of the fire. Kathy in Oregon, I understand that when we die, we go into an intermediate body. I've been told this and I can't find it in Scripture. Please give me some insight. This is an intermediate physical body that we are given before we go to be with Jesus. There's no such thing as an intermediate physical body. As it's written in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 7 and 8, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord, and you do so in a spiritual body. Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verses 6 and 7, when we die, the spirit, the flesh, returns to the earth from which it came. Your spirit returns to the Father in a spiritual body, not a physical body. I'm out of time. I want you all to know that I love you a great deal. Why? Because you enjoy studying your Father's Word in depth. And you know what? It makes Father's Day when he looks down and he sees you reading the letter he wrote to you, the Bible. Blessings always follow. We are brought to you by your tithes and offerings. If we've helped you, help us keep coming to you and to reach out to others who are lost in this world of darkness. One thing most important is this: you stay in his word every day. Every day in your Father's word is a good day, even with trouble. You know why? Because Jesus is the living word.
Hearing God's word with understanding will change your life. We hope you have enjoyed studying God's word here on the Shepherd's Chapel Family Bible Study Hour with Pastor Dennis Murray. If you would like to receive more information concerning Shepherd's Chapel, you may request our free introductory offer. Our introductory offer contains the Mark of the Beast CD, our monthly newsletter with a written Bible study, a CD catalog, and a list of written reference works available through Shepherd's Chapel. To request our free introductory offer by telephone, call 800-643-4645. 24 hours a day. You may also request our introductory offer by writing to Shepherd's Chapel, P.O. Box 416, Gravette, Arkansas, 72736. Once again, that's Shepherd's Chapel, P.O. Box 416, Gravette, Arkansas, 72736. We invite you to join us for the next in-depth Bible study each weekday at the same time. Thank you for watching today's program, and God bless you.
Mark. Mark, one of the apostles, Mark having been a very young lad at the time Christ walked this earth, was always in the shadows, observing and listening with the intensity that young ears can, picking up every word. And this great gospel moves very fast. But what a interesting and certainly impressive gospel it is for Mark, from those that young mind, reiterates to you in chapter 13 how some are going to be delivered up, exactly what they are supposed to do. And even in that 13th chapter, giving you the seven events that fulfill this or make up the seven seals and the seven trumpets, and telling you how you are to react to them. A fast-moving gospel, one that I know you'll enjoy.
Gravette, Arkansas, this is Shepherd's Chapel with Pastor Arnold Murray. Join with us now as Pastor Murray takes you on a book-by-book, chapter-by-chapter, line-by-line study of God's Word. Now, here is Pastor Murray.
All right, good day to you. God bless you. Welcome to the Shepherd's Chapel. Welcome to this Family Bible Study Hour. Praise God, it's good to have an opportunity to meet with you, to study His Word and get deeper in God's truth. We just thank our Father for the privilege of the platform that joins us together spiritually and visually and auditably to